Good afternoon, everybody. This is our third webinar, I think. And today we have Marco Ciurcina, actually Professor Marco Ciurcina, who will hold a webinar about GDPR and cryptography and blockchain. So we'll talk about hashing, encrypting, GDPR in terms of storage of data on a blockchain, on a database that is encrypted or non-encrypted. Marco, welcome. Thank you very much for being here. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to talk about this topic that is a really fascinating topic. It's an area of the law that it's more interesting for me in this moment because it's challenging at the root what the law is and how impact with the activities of people. So I'll show you some slides, and the first thing I want to do is to, if you want to dig into this topic, I suggest you to read these two documents. Maybe if you are curious people, already cross them, and they're the most interesting documents about this topic.
I am Googling them and posting a link in the chat as soon as I find them.
Okay, cool. The first one is report from CNIL. CNIL is the supervising authority, French supervising authority, that published in 2018, almost a long time ago, I would say, because it's 2 years ago, a document expressing some, clarifying some points, some issues of about blockchains and GDPR. Of course, CNIL is responsible for applying GDPR in France, and it's the most, authoritative, the document with more authority that says something about GDPR, because there are many articles, many doctrinal papers about GDPR, but what says this CNIL document has more value because it comes from the French supervising authority. Then the second document, which is much more extensive, it's hundreds of, more than 100 pages. It's a study commissioned by the European Parliament, Blockchain and the General Data Protection Regulation. And it's much more recent. It's a 2020 document. So it's very new, but it's also, it's a very good document analyzing issues related to GDPR. It says much more than the things that are relevant for blockchain. So it's a good document also if you're not interested in blockchain, but it touches all the issues that are related to blockchain. Now, what I will do now is try to go to the basics, I will say, because I think is important for you to grasp some basic concepts to understand how to play with the opportunities, but also with the risks that poses GDPR to people that are interested in building businesses using the blockchain. So the first thing to clarify is what is personal data. Personal data, this is defined, all the definitions come from Article 4 of, one premise. I will try to speak 30 minutes, then I will give you the floor and I will be open to discuss, to deepen specific aspects and tell you what I know and tell you what I don't know, because this is also very much possible. That's something I'm not able to give you a clear answer. Okay, so Article 4 of GDPR, Regulation 2016-689, says that personal data is any information relating to an identified or identifiable natural person. So every information that relates to a person, identified or not, identifiable, is personal data. I used to use this example to make you understand, because the key here is what does identifiable mean? A person is identifiable also if you are not able to identify him, but somebody else is. So to give you an example, the IP address from which a person connects to your website is personal data, because it says from which IP that person is connecting, and the fact that you know the IP address allows you to make personal data all the log that is related to that IP address. So you could say, but I don't know who's connecting from that IP address. Yes, you don't, but the internet service provider of that person knows who's behind that IP. Then that person is not identified by you, but it's identifiable. So the key issue to understand the notion of personal data is understanding what identifiable means. A person that can be identified by also third parties, not only by you. Then data subject is an identified or identifiable natural person, a person that can be identified by their reference identifier, such a name, an identification number, location data, etc., etc., etc. That's also in Article 4. What says this to us when we talk about blockchain? That well, we will dig more about this later. Commitment that relates to information about the person, or hash that refers to information, to data that contains information about the person, and encrypted data, of course, can be personal data, because the fact that we will dig more about this, the fact that data is encrypted does not change the nature of personal data, of that data. The fact that you cannot have access to the information because it's encrypted doesn't change the nature of personal data, of the data encrypted, as long as somebody is able to decrypt that data. So the fact that personal data is encrypted doesn't change the nature of personal data, and hashing or using commitment can be also can imply processing personal data. Now I write you these three examples because actually this is interesting to know. This is the, how can I say, the first option, commitment, second option, hashing with the K-dashing, as they call it, and encrypting are the three options that could be under certain circumstances viable to register personal data in a blockchain. And CNIL suggests to adopt commitment or hash or encrypted. First option, commitment. Second option, hashing. Third option, encrypting. Another thing that comes out from the nature of personal data is that the data subject that processed his own personal data is not, we will see this later actually, is not a controller. Then personal use of data is not covered by GDPR. When you register your own personal data for personal use, you're not due to apply the GDPR, even though there is some cases from the Court of Justice of the European Union that says that making available data about third parties that in a way that are accessible through the internet could be not subject to the exception for personal use. Now, the controller. The controller is the person, the entity, that makes decision about the goals and the means of the processing of personal data. Then the controller is the one who makes the fundamental choices about the processing of personal data, the goals and means of the processing. All the others that collaborate with the controller are processors. Then all the companies, that all the third parties that support, provide services to the controller in order to process personal data, they're processors. They are third parties that process personal data on behalf of the controller under an agreement, a written agreement with the controller. CNIL analyzes whether there are the persons that the entities that operate in a blockchain can be controllers or not. The suggestion of CNIL is that who has writing rights in the blockchain is a controller, then has to comply with the obligation provided by the GDPR. Miners, according to CNIL, should not be controllers. And according to CNIL, private persons should not be controllers, even though there is this case law that suggests to be more cautious in excluding always people acting on for private purpose, considering this case law, this doctrine that suggests that when you publish on the internet data, personal data, that especially they refer to third parties, you are subject to the obligation provided by the GDPR. Then another suggestion made by the CNIL is that developers of smart contracts could possibly be processors. So it's particularly important to give limits to the activity of the smart contract developers in order to exclude the responsibility for them in the making available of smart contracts that allow to process personal data. Processing. What is processing? Any operation that relates to personal data. Any possible use, registering, collecting, collection, recording, organizing, structuring, storage, adoption or alteration. Every possible action that relates to personal data is processing. Then this is important to think into account that every possible use of a blockchain to process personal data is processing. Then some definitions that is one definition that is important to keep in mind is the definition of pseudonymization. The processing of personal data in such a manner that the personal data can no longer be attributed to a specific data subject without the use of additional information is pseudonymization. So separating data that allow to identify a person and the information is pseudonymization. Pseudonymized data is still personal data. Is pseudonymized data. Pseudonymizing data is good in terms of GDPR in the sense that pseudonymizing data pseudonymizing is a technique that allows to show that to a certain degree some obligations provided by the GDPR are complied with, but still pseudonymizing is not excluding that that data is personal data. In order to say that data is no longer personal data, you have to anonymize data. That is, transform that data in a way that is no longer referred to a single, a specific individual, a specific natural person. So, anonymizing data that is on the blockchain is something that is not always easy to achieve. Then also this says to us that encrypted data, as I told you, is still personal data. The fact that data is encrypted is good in terms of GDPR because provides for a mean for to show that some of the obligations provided for the controller are complied with, for example, the minimization, the security obligation, the privacy by design by default obligations could be better complied with if the data is encrypted, but the fact that data is encrypted doesn't allow you to forget about GDPR. So encrypting and pseudonymizing is good, but does not imply that you are not due to comply with the obligation that the controller is due to comply with when he processes personal data. Then I made a selection here of the obligations that controllers have to comply with to make some, how can I say, some considerations about. One obligation that is important to consider is the minimization obligation. That is, the controller has to minimize processing of personal data. If there are two options, the controller should prefer an option that minimizes processing of personal data. So this drove the CNIL to make some considerations about identifiers of people using the blockchain, identifiers of users of the blockchain. Okay, according to the CNIL, use of, the, of identifiers is necessary in the sense that if you want, if you have to use a blockchain, now this doesn't reply to the question if you have to, but if you have to use an identifier seems to be necessary and so minimized, let's say. So use of identifiers complies with the obligation of minimization as long as use of the blockchain is okay according to the other obligations provided by the GDPR. Now, another obligation that is important to consider is considering the data retention period. The blockchain unfortunately doesn't allow to delete that data. Then very often choosing blockchain as a technology for processing personal data is not a good choice because you can't minimize the data retention period. All the data that you put on a blockchain will be there as long as the blockchain will continue to be working because it's in the blockchain. This could be an issue to consider to get to the conclusion that using a blockchain in the specific circumstances is not a good option. But according to the CNIL, as long as the blockchain is the option, identifiers, for example, is okay that are stored forever in the blockchain because it's part of the working of the blockchain, the fact that identifiers are stored together forever. Then the issue of erasure and rectification. This is an obligation provided for by GDPR, and this poses a problem because, I would say something more. How can I say? Don't consider the obligation to erase data or rectify data as an obligation that applies always. So the obligation to erase data or rectify data is very, how can I say, it's not cut in stone when you have to erase data and when you have not to erase or rectify data. The problem is the gray areas, when you don't know if you have to or you have not to. Because if you're not sure now, maybe you could be sure in the future. Because one problem with GDPR is that it's very new. It's new legislation. It has 2 years. And the Court of Justice didn't work a lot on clarifying the exact meaning of the text of the GDPR. So there are many areas where the answer to a question is not white, it's not black, but it's gray. And when erasing and rectifying is mandatory, is one of those areas where there's not clear answer. And another aspect to consider, CNIL, for example, considers suggests to deepen in next years, but the issue is still open, if some techniques could be considered erasure. For example, if some data is accessible only using other information like commitments or CAID hashes, if you delete the the information that allows you to access the information stored on the blockchain, maybe, suggests the CNIL, maybe, you are erasing the data. And so the problem is that a clear answer to this question is not available now. There are different opinions. This is gray. This is an area of gray. Another very important obligation, this is provided by Article 22 of GDPR, is the obligation for the controller to allow the data subjects, the interested person, to be allowed to oppose decision based on automated processing. So this, according to many authors, according to CNIL also, and according also to the study of the EU Parliament, this could be something to consider when you make processing based on smart contracts. If you process personal data using smart contract, you have to consider in the design of that smart contract that somebody could oppose to this processing, and then should be possible to allow people to contest the processing based on smart contracts. Somehow there are different techniques to achieve this. Another issue that is unsolved is the issue of extra way data transfer, extra European Union data transfer, because blockchains are accessible all over the world, and there's no way to avoid this. And so this is another open issue when you talk about using blockchains for processing personal data. Then the obligations of privacy by design and privacy by default. The controller, according to Article 25 of GDPR, before starting designing processing, should make an analysis in order to check if the technology, the processing is performed in a way that is that protects privacy of the data subjects by design and by default. This evaluation should be in concrete, should be done in concrete according to the criteria suggested by Article 25, and then the decision to adopt a blockchain should not be the starting point, should be the final point of when you get to a decision according to the criteria that and then should be the best choice to protect privacy of the user. This implies that not always use of blockchains is recommendable, but also suggests that in some cases could be a good option to process personal data. Then another issue very important to consider, particularly when you talk about processing of personal data in blockchain, is the privacy impact assessment obligation. When, in my humble opinion, today at this stage, at this level of maturity of the debate about blockchains, every data processing, every personal data processing that includes a blockchain should go through a privacy impact assessment. The privacy impact assessment is mandatory according to the GDPR when under certain circumstances the use of technologies that information technologies that imply a certain risk is one of those conditions that my strong feeling, but I'm not alone saying this, is that making a privacy impact assessment is something to do before deciding to adopt blockchains for processing personal data. And if the privacy impact assessment basically is going through a process, a formalized process of analysis, in order to check if the processing of personal data is secure, is compliant with GDPR. In order to do this, there are different techniques. The one that I suggest to adopt because it's the easiest one is to use the software, a free software made by CNIL, the French supervising authority, that incorporates a methodology. So it's a software, it's a tool that allows you to analyze a specific data processing to check if it's secure, it's okay for processing personal data. And if the privacy impact assessment ends with a conclusion that there is some residual risk, it's necessary for the controller to ask to its supervising authority, the supervising authority of his own country. And the supervising authority has a period to reply and suggest further measures to better protect the privacy of the data subjects. The last thing I want to mention is the identification of the legal base for processing. Every processing is based on has to have a legal base in order to be legitimate. And legal bases are provided by Article 6 in general for all personal data. Possible legal base are the contract, consent, or give another example, a law providing for a specific processing. So this is just to let you know that sometimes use of blockchains could be suggested or provided by laws. But this is something that we will see in the future if this will happen. Then this is my very general presentation. I'm open to questions and okay.
Explícito con ellos, de interés por nuestra función. Entonces, lo que hemos hecho es plantearles también, porque claro, al final, por lo tanto, a las
figuras. We cannot hear you.
I finished. I finished.
I know. There is someone else talking.
Antonio
Orvio. You can mute him, I guess.
No, but Antonio, are you talking to us or... Or was it just noise?
You can mute him, I guess.
No, he's muted.
Okay. I thought he was asking questions. All right, good. Thank you very much, Marco. Are there questions?
Hi, Marco.
I would encourage.
Oh, sorry.
Hi.
This is Teresa.
Yeah.
I have a question in regards to what you mentioned on the retention of the data. So do you know how currently other companies are dealing with this thing? I understand that depends a bit on the use of that data and if there's any regulatory requirement to keep that data for a number of years of a period. But I don't know if there's already some approaches as to how to deal with once that has expired.
Once that?
Has expired. Like if you cannot retain personal data for more than 6 years, and after that, as you mentioned, the retention of the data, you cannot retain that data anymore. If you know how they are dealing currently, other companies with that.
You mean not with blockchains, you're talking about in general
with
about
blockchain. No, blockchain.
With blockchain, the problem is that you cannot delete the blockchain. So the data that is in the blockchain will stay there. So this is something that should be considered. And the general rule is to avoid to register in the blockchain data that it's better that at a certain point should not be retained anymore. So every data that is that have to be deleted at a certain point should be out of the blockchain. Then you could leave in the blockchain identifiers, of course, because it's in the nature of being identified by a string of text in the blockchain that it should be there forever and should be not used by third parties. Then a possible, I would not suggest to write in the blockchain personal data in plain text or even encrypted. I would suggest to have in the blockchain something that allows to prove that commitments or hash K dash is not personal data, because if you have personal data in the blockchain, then how can you delete it?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you for clarifying.
Okay. Do we have more questions?
We have one in the chat.
Let's see. Okay, Sebastian. Sebastian asks that they are recording the patient's voice. So they're recording an audio file and they're considering to store that on a blockchain, I guess. Right, Sebastian? Yes, he says yes.
Well, if you know who's the patient, that's personal data.
Okay, so if you need to be able to couple that with the name and or ID number.
An ID number that somebody is able to couple with a person. Now, the issue with the voices, faces, etc., is that the technological landscape is changing in the last years. And to give you an example, if you already used some services, now your face can be coupled with your name by the providers of those services. So, face, voice, fingerprints. It's difficult to exclude that are personal data, because there's a high risk that somebody, even without you being able to, could be able to re-identify the person that is connected to that voice or face or fingerprint. And then I would suggest to be very very careful in registering and recording in blockchain this data. But according to the circumstances, this could be viable. Just this, how can I say, a point of attention, because when you, the face, you don't know me, but Google knows who I am.
Okay, do we have an answer from Sebastian in chat? He says, thank
you're
you.
You're welcome.
There is another question from Alvaro, but guys, you can also, you're welcome to speak. Yes. You can unmute yourself and ask the question. I think it's going
to
be easier.
Maybe they don't want to be their voice registered in order to be recognized.
Makes sense. But anyway, Alvaro asks, if we save only the hash of the voice file, but you consider the voice as personal data.
Now, the hash of the voice file, if there's a need to register such data, I would suggest to consider the possibility to record them in the form of keyed hashes, or in a way that if you throw away something, nobody's able to couple that hash to the voice.
So when you say keyed hashes, you mean password-based hashes. So the algorithms are, hold on a second, there are several that can be used. Hold on. So we have password-based hashing, HMAC, and or a key derivation function. So there are several ways that you can do a password-protected hash. Yes, that's I guess what you were talking about, Marco.
I think so, because I know what password-based hash are, and I had the strong feeling that it's the same thing that Knilis refers to when he says keyed hash. I think it's the same, but I don't know why.
I think so as well.
IPFS. The problem with IPFS is the possibility to delete data. Question is, because I don't know very well the technology, and I'm not sure you can delete data. Then if you cannot delete data, you have to ask yourself, am I in a position that I'm required, according to certain circumstances, to delete that data? Then I don't know. I never digged into this. I just have general information that says that in IPFS you can't delete data once data is there. This poses me the question. Poses me the question to investigate a few issues. I mean, what should I put there? I mean, maybe not clear text, clear data, maybe encrypted data, maybe even better. What? Yeah. This is the okay. That just to finish the question, the fact that the question is if EPFS allows or not to delete data. If the answer is no, then you have to ask yourself: is it privacy by design and by default compliant? And does comply with the obligation of Article 16, 17 that provide for the obligation to delete data and modify and adapt, rectify data. The fact that I cannot delete. So these are questions that depend on specific circumstances. And so I suggest to dig into these questions. You're welcome. Then I see Miaela published the link to the PIA software. Yes, I suggest you to consider to use this tool in order to self assess whether you are doing the right things to process personal data using a blockchain. So, but if you process personal data using a blockchain or EPFS, this is something to be digged into.
This is Peter from GeneCoop. I have a question for Marco.
Yeah.
What I see and I have seen also with the genetic developments for the past years, that genetic data is considered the highest class of personal data because it's always identifiable, and also the files which we have are unique to each person. So they're the highest class of personal data. But the challenge, what I see, is that we want to provide, I think most of us, as technology tech providers, so processor types of services to support data transactions and data value creation for end users. But the end users need to have the privacy impact assessments and they are part of the organization, right? Because they're the controllers of the data. And in most cases, we will just, I think, be processors of their data and not the organization that controls the data. Mm-hmm. So how do you see that development? Because there's I see with hospitals, for instance, they don't have a clue what this is because it's so new anyway for them with the GDPR. But are there in your network and also movements, basically, of best practices, how to set this up?
I used to say that people providing services, that technologies that allow third parties to process personal data as controllers should consider making a privacy impact assessment of their technology, mm-hmm. and making it available as a, how can I say, as a standard privacy impact assessment is because it's a marketing tool. If you can show to your clients that your technology can pass a privacy impact assessment successfully, you will find less resistances to adopt your technology, because all the questions that they have are applied by the privacy impact assessment. And so if your market is clients that would use the technology, I strongly recommend you to make a privacy impact assessment, because this would multiply the market, the reach of your technology in the market.
I think that's a great suggestion. I don't know, Andrea, is it also possible to have this as part of, because I think a lot of, it's not just our company, but most of us will benefit from that. And because at least we want to use also the existing Dyn technology, for instance, which has been developed, probably already had some parts of privacy impact assessment done. I would like to basically not reinvent the wheel and try to see what already was developed also from this privacy impact assessment, and then also try to use the best practices on this area. Because what I see in the Netherlands, for instance, is that each institute or each care provider network is reinventing the wheel themselves, because they only do it for themselves. The privacy impact assessment is also a specific one, so it's not a generic one, which I would guess we would need, but it's not there. And then indeed, for the big parties like Microsoft and so on, they have their own privacy impact assessments, but that's a marketing thing. So there's a big gap between what is there from the bigger companies who know about this, small companies who don't know it, and then the market who's just, I think, basically quite immature in their way of managing the whole process.
Peter, I halfway understand your question. I'm not sure I understand what you need. We have never done, we as Dyn, we've never done any assessment like this because we are technology developers. Something in that direction was done within the Decode project. I think that Marco worked on it. But if you have specific needs, then let us know and we'll see. If and how we can help.
Yeah, I think if Decode and Marco have developed a privacy impact assessment for Decode, that would be very useful, because then we have a basis, because we want to build on that anyway.
Actually, in Decode, my suggestion was to make a privacy impact assessment if we were going to use the blockchain to process personal data. But the decision was not to register personal data, to record personal data on the blockchain. That's because we registered the results of votes, but not personal data.
I understand that's yeah. That's very smart, because then you, of course, by design don't have a problem.
Very good, exactly. So it's in the code, finally, we didn't need to make a privacy impact assessment because we didn't use the blockchain to process personal data, but
yeah, and we have the problem with the gene co-op that we have a dynamic consent, which is controlled by the citizen or the patient. So that's personal anyway, and that needs to be protected very well. And we can't de-identify that in a way, but also not. But that's why we probably will need that privacy impact assessment in this case, because we cannot do it another way, because it's personal consent we're talking about.
I suggest you to have a look to the software, which is, it's easy. It doesn't take a long time to go through a process of making a privacy impact assessment.
Is there a link for that?
Yes, it's up there, CNILPIA, Privacy Impact Assessment Open Source Tool. In the chat, you have the link to the software.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.